Ladies and gentlemen, I've enjoyed being here. It's a blessing. When you get together with brethren, you don't have to know people. They're just family automatically, and that's what makes it good. Okay? If you would, take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 11, verse 36. That'll be our verse tonight for the message. And you all know the situation. Jesus is at a funeral. John 11:36. Then said the Jews, "Behold, how he loved him." Let's open a prayer. Heavenly Father, we pray in Jesus' name again. I thank you for the privilege to be a Christian. Father, I thank you for these folks. Father, I pray that your Spirit would come out of me, that it minister to them, that it would heal them, that it would encourage them, that it would help them to separate and sanctify, that it would convict them of sin, that it would exhort them to righteousness. I ask and pray these things in Jesus' name. I thank you for the privilege to serve you. All right, hereby perceive we the love of God, because he laid down his life for us, and we ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. That's something Christians aren't listening to much today. You've got to learn to listen to all the Word of God, the whole counsel of God, you see, and we need to be willing and learn how to lay our lives down for the brethren. The Lord didn't have any problem doing that. Then said the Jews, "Behold how he loved them." When the Lord was at the gravesite, his love was apparent for the soul of that individual. And we need to learn to love as God would have us love the brethren. One of the great needs of the churches of the Lord Jesus Christ is to learn to love the brethren as the Lord Jesus Christ did. You need to realize that. When you find a brother or sister that you find hard to tolerate or hard to love or hard to befriend, Jesus still died for him. Jesus still saved him. Jesus still loved him. And there must be something wrong with you, because Jesus didn't have any problem of redeeming him. It's the love of God for the souls of men and the brethren that we need to learn. And that's the way. If you want to learn to love somebody, you can't try to love somebody in the flesh and love their flesh. Some people's flesh is just ugly. Some people's conduct and character is just reprehensible. So what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to look at an individual, see a soul, a living, breathing soul, a soul that's going to die and go to hell and perish for all eternity, a soul that's going to be in heaven for all eternity. And when I go over there, I'm going over and preach to black people. Black people have a different culture than we have. We have a different culture as white people. In America, there's a strain to that thing. I've been that way for years. No different. We're all flesh. We're all flesh and blood. We all have a soul. Yeah. If you look past the color and you look at the soul, you don't have any problem. That's what you need to look at, the soul. John 15:9, "As the Father loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love." That's important. You see, you need to know the law. The law is a school teacher to bring us to Christ. Knowing the law will get you saved. That as you really get to learn the law and find out you can't keep the law, you can't fulfill the law is just impossible on your flesh and on yourself, you're going to have to find a Savior. And that's what's good about it. That's how to use the law lawfully. You want to preach to get people saved? Give them the law. Show them that they got no hope. Show them that just because you haven't murdered anybody, just as you haven't raped anybody, that doesn't matter. You violate that law on one point, you're finished in all points. Show them where they've lied. Everybody's lied. I haven't murdered anybody yet. That's the best way to put it. I haven't murdered anybody yet. But I've lied to people. You have too. Don't look at me and tell me you haven't. You're lying to me right now. See? I got you. I know you lied to people. We all sin. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. You don't want to admit that, you're calling God a liar. That's why people go to hell, calling the Almighty a liar. God says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." So the commandments here, you want to realize these are the commandments of Jesus Christ. Now, they're in harmony. I gave them to you. I gave you those precepts and those principles today. But if you study the New Testament, you'll find there's 49 commandments of the Lord that he gives. And when you get into, I give you so you understand doctrinally, those are kingdom commandments. And you can spiritualize every one of them for our age. But if you go into the Pauline epistles, all 49 of those commandments that the Lord Jesus Christ gives, Paul presents them in Romans, Ephesians, Galatians, correct for our doctrine and our time and age. But, it doesn't take much to spiritualize them, and they're good. I'll tell you a commandment, and we'll come to it somewhere in my message, but fundamentalists have a hard time with whatsoever you would that men should do unto you, do you so likewise unto them, for this is the law and the prophets. And that's a great error. I mean, you can't get saved with that, but that's the way we're going to live in eternity. You better get used to that commandment. That's a kingdom commandment. That's the way it's going to be when we get to heaven. Yeah. All right? Now, I know the liberals are trying to get everybody to heaven. Now, you can't get to heaven with good works. We know that. But that doesn't mean you trash God's principles for character and God's principles of life. And that's a principle of life. So you need to pay attention to the law and learn the law. But the law is going to make you miserable. Because every time, that's what I ran that poor fellow. It's like, he was like, how come I don't have your liberty and freedom and the power to preach and all this? And it's like, I only got it today. I mean, I just come up here and I ask the Lord to bless me. I mean, it's because I'm not trying to live the law. I failed at the law. So what I do is I try to stay in my playpen, and I do, you know, the Lord sets my bounds, and I in my playpen I play and have fun. Sometimes I play hard, sometimes I play soft, and I just have that liberty and enjoy it, and it gives me my joy and my strength. These things have I spoken unto you, that my joy might remain in you. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. God wants his joy in you. And today, most Christians don't have God's joy. And you can tell they fake it because they don't have it in their singing. They don't have it in their life. They don't have it, you know, when they're alone. They're not walking around humming, in my heart there rings a melody. They're not walking around saying, arise my soul. You know, they just don't have it. Now, I don't have the gift of talent. But I sing all the time by myself, and I sing in my house, you know. I'm there studying, watching my computer, and singing. Oh, I'll tell you, you want joy, get Jehus, man of I can't remember the name of the title. It's classical music by Joy of Man's Desire. There we go, Joy of Man's Desire. Listen to that. Read your Bible. You'll be the joy. A lot of Handel stuff. You get all. See, for years I would read my Bible with Christian singing. They had good songs and bad songs. It was hard to get a big repertoire of songs. I mean, what I mean by that, they didn't. Some know how to play the music right, and some don't know how to play music right. They put in the backbeat stuff like that, you know. And so, I mean, I've got. In desperation, I've got Elvis singing in my father's house for many mansions. It's beautiful, but as far as I'm concerned, I mean, God knows, but I think Elvis died and went to hell. And definitely, he had no character. And I didn't mean to offend you, but I mean, I'm sorry. The king had no character. The king's probably in hell. He's probably going to be the king of hell. That's probably. I didn't say, I'm not God. I can't condemn him. He might get saved. He might have been saved. I don't know. There's a lot of people that think he was a backslidden Christian. I don't know. Only God knows, okay? But that's neither here nor there. What you want to realize is this. Even with good Christian music, I'd have some of the brethren, and I have, you know, their things. I'd listen to them. I make my own tapes. But when people are singing, you can't really concentrate on your reading. That's the problem. Even if it's a good song. Then, I don't know, it was about a year ago now, the Lord opened up the door and said, you know, get good Christian music from the masters and play that music and read, and then you can concentrate. And man, this is exciting. Maybe it won't work for you, but boy, for me, it's a blessing. So I get that. I got a lot of Handel. Baldy has Spring, the lively songs. Ein Klein Music, something like that, with Wolfgang Amadeus Mozart. Now, I don't know. Maybe he was, the movie said he was a bum. But I don't know what he saved or lost. But boy, that music's nice. It's lively. It's joy. And you listen to that music and read the scriptures and concentrate. And look for the revelation of Jesus Christ. You see, people read the Bible wrong way. Even the Bible believers, you know, I don't have to prove to you I'm a Bible believer, but, you know, that I believe the King James Bible. Sounds to me like you don't believe it. You're trying to impress me that you do, see? And then on top of that, then you get the intellectual ones. Well, you know, this and this and this and this and this and this. But that's not the book of the Revelation. You see, there should be. I learned something from an insane individual once. We were out street preaching. This was back when Reagan tossed all the mentally impaired out of the asylums. And so we're out street preaching, and we're preaching out the book of Revelation. It's like the book of Revelation, you know. And this fellow decided to mock us, you know. So he grabbed one of our Bibles, and he stood up and he said, "This book of the Revelation!" And the Lord said, "See that, stupid? That dummy knows more about what that book is than you do. Because this book's the whole revelation. This is God revealing himself." Amen. Now, if you want to grow, you want to pray and say, "Lord, reveal yourself to me. Let me get to know you. Let me get to understand you. Paul said that I might know him and the power of his resurrection. Then you're going to start learning what the Bible's all about. Then you're going to be a Bible believer. Because then you're going to eat it. His word was like honey, and I did eat it. Now you got to be careful. You should only take what's sufficient for you. Less like honey, lest you vomit it. You see, because knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. A lot of our brethren, and I've been there. A lot of my Christian life, I was there with knowledge, with a big head, but a poor heart. And you want to be careful. This commandment, that ye love one another as I have loved you. Greater love hath no man than this, than man laid down his life for his friends. If you really love somebody, people say, oh, I love you. Well, if you're not willing to lay your life down for them, you don't really love them. You're just saying it. You're just trying to impress them. That's what's killing marriages. Mm-hmm. You know, a man ought to be willing to die for his wife, and a husband, and wife ought to be willing to reverence her husband. She ought to reverence him like God. But you got to have true love. You got to have sacrificial love. You got to have a sense of death in yourself to love that way. Ye are my friends if ye do whatsoever I command you. Henceforth I call you not servants, for the servant knoweth not what his Lord doth. But I have called you friends, for all things that I have heard of my Father I have made known that ye should unto you. You have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. These things I command you, that ye love one another. Now, what he's commanding is real love. He's commanding soul love, heart love. That's what he's commanding. The Lord desires was that his disciples would have the same godly love his Father had for him that he had for them. He taught them that if they truly loved him, they would keep the morality of his commandments. And that's what God wants you to be. He wants you to be moral men. All right? You know, there's some times when it gets real sticky. There's some times, there's some fine lines you got to be very careful. There's some times when you can, the Bible tells you, you can create mischief by the law. A lot of times people use the law to do evil. And you can do that. Okay? And that's a bad spirit. That's a bad heart. For the grace of God that bringeth salvation appeareth unto all men, teaching us to deny ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. There's your instructions. Looking for that blessed hope and the glorious appearing of great God and our Savior, Jesus Christ. I want to bring your attention to the blessed hope. You've got people today just can't wait till the Lord takes them out so they get out of their trials and all their problems. Oh, I'm so tired of this life. Can't wait. Your heart's wrong. That's the wrong thing. That's bad, okay? Then you got the others who says, oh, I want the Lord to come. I don't want to face the Antichrist. That's wrong. Your heart's not right. You know, the blessed hope is when I can't wait till I see him. I want to see him. I want to know him. I'm hungering for him. You see, that's the blessed hope. It's when you're looking for him to return. Yeah. That's why a lot of the brethren get mad at me. That's why I won't use that word rapture. That's why I use the word translation, because we were translated in the kingdom. And there's a different meaning in translation and rapture. Rapture's got some sexual immorality in it. It means it goes with rape. And the brethren get all mad because they're so stalwart for 100 years. They've been saying, can't wait for the rapture, can't wait for the rapture. And then I come up and say, I can't wait for the translation. And this is a heretic. He doesn't believe in the blessed hope. And that is the blessed hope, because I'm going to get changed from me to him. Amen. That's the blessed hope. I won't be me anymore. I'll be him. Yeah, I'll be a new creature. More new than I am now with my new birth. I'll have a body that's righteous. And a mind that's righteous. And a heart that's righteous. Looking for that blessed hope. That's your hope. Glorious appearing. The great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us that he might redeem us from all iniquity. And purify unto self a peculiar people, zealous of good works. These things speak and exhort and rebuke with all authority. So get out there and do something good. Amen. Let no man despise thee. That throws a lot of people down. You try to do right. The minute you try to do right, somebody slaps you down. Yeah. I've had that happen. Oh, you get that at fellowship meetings. Not so much these days, but you come up to fellowship and you preach a message. And I'll tell you some secret right now about the Bible. Protect yourself if you ever in the ministry of preaching. That book has at least 5 senses to it. And I'll tell you, it's like, God will take care of you. That's a good sense. God will take care of you. And God will take care of you. That's a negative sense. So you got a positive and negative on every verse. As the Father loved me, so have I loved you. That could be positive and that could be negative. In other words, you can say, as the Father loved me, so I've loved you. And that, and you can also imply it as like, and so you're out. That's a negative, see? You can take any verse, do positive, negative. Then every verse has a historical, it has a doctrinal, it has a spiritual application. So you've got three more senses. You've got at least five senses. Now what happens is a man of God will get up and preach a message like I'm preaching right now, and then a devil will get up, and it may be a saved brother, and twist everything that you said and make your positives negatives and your negatives positive, make you look like an idiot. I've had that happen to me. I'll give you a good example of that. I had it happen in my own church on a number of occasions. You say, what do you do about it? I don't even pay any attention to it. I just let it go. But I'll tell you what happened to me. I have a small church. I can only take on so many missionaries. My church maxed out on missionaries. Missionaries come and, well, you know, can you take us on? No, but I do the next best thing. I'm having a church revival. I have a whole bunch of preachers there. Come on, I'll give you an answer, introduce yourself, and you can give them a chance to preach if I got a slot. And what more can they ask for? And maybe some other brother can take you on and can forward you, because I can't right now. So I did that, and I even said that. You know what? In my own church, a guy got up and told everybody how I had a bad heart because I didn't take on the next missionary. That if I really loved God, I would find out a way to take him on. In my own church!
Wow.
You know? People do that to you. Tell you what else I had happen in my own church. And I don't have any malice. I did at the time. You get mad at the time, and then I get over it as quick as I can. You say, why is that? I've done stupid things and mean things to people. I've done it unintentionally. We're having a big revival at our church, and we're having an evening service. And a brother gets up to preach, and he invites everybody over to his church for the evening service. Like, excuse me, I'm having a service here tonight. What, we're supposed to shut it down and go over there? You know?
Yeah.
Say, what's that? Imbecilic? Yeah. That's a word I made up for imbecile. I don't know if there's such thing as imbecilic, but you get the message, see?
Yeah.
So what do you do with a brother like that? Well, you forgive him. Now, you instruct him. Next time he comes to you, now look, you're going to preach here today, now do me a favor. I know you didn't mean to do it. See, this is what people won't do. But I don't appreciate it if you invite the members of my church and my visitors over to your church when I'm having church tonight. Okay? And that's what you do. I set people straight. We were at the fellowship thing. I was telling you about that, and I'm telling you a lot about it since it just happened. But we're sitting there with a fine Christian lady, two fine Christian ladies. But one fine Christian lady got up and left her her plate right there. And the other Christian lady says, and she started to complain about it. She said, I'm a bad Christian. I said, no, here's, you're not a bad Christian, but tell her. It does, if you tell me, you're bad-mouthing her. When she comes back, and you don't have to be mean, just say, when she comes back, or if you see her, say, I think you left your plate. Don't you want to take it? Just remind her. How many times do you leave things? I do that. I forget. I'm a litter bug. I try not to be. I mean, I went through all those things back in the 60s, you know, with the crying Indian and everything else, and I try not to be a litter bug. But especially now with my little lozenges that I you know, a little piece of paper. And then somebody says, now, that's just me being forgetful. If somebody says, you're littering! And I'll stop for a couple of weeks, you know? So these people need to be reminded. And that's what we don't do. But we can remind people without vindictiveness. We can remind people without bitterness, and we can do it with wisdom, and we can help them help themselves. That's what the love of the brethren is. Who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity, and purify on himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. All right, those today whose heart is not as toward the Lord desire to walk in the love of the Spirit and live righteously and godly in this present world. That's what you're told. For the brethren, you have been called on to liberty. Isn't that liberty wonderful? Isn't that wonderful to have that playpen? You can do anything you want in those bounds. So you've got all kinds of freedom. Everything but sin. That's the only thing God doesn't want you to do. You want to eat a nice big meal? Well, if you don't eat yourself into a heart attack, fine. Okay, and if you're eating yourself into a heart attack, then you're going to have to skip a few meals. Okay? But you can do anything you want. You want to marry a wife and have children, then you just have to be responsible. You have to feed the kids. You have to pay your taxes. You have to buy your property, you know, or rent your apartment. But it's a wonderful life. And Christians, I can't get over it. It's not just one Christian that all we can do is eat. I've run into a lot of bitter Christians. And in fact, I had a few times in my life when I was bitter. But then the Lord dealt with me and showed me his liberty. And boy, since he showed me his liberty, I'm free. Free indeed. Amen. For all the law is fulfilled in this one word, even this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. Love thy neighbor as thyself. I tell you what, if somebody's standing on your toes, you don't like that. I love myself. If somebody stands on my toes, they give me pain. So instead of complaining, though, I say, excuse me, you stand on my toes. And if they say, well, that's tough, then I give them a little push and shove them off, you know. But hey, it's better. You start off nice, you know. Those of us who would bite and devour their brethren or sisters are carnal, immature, and without brotherly love. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed to be not consumed one of another. This I say then. You know, you can talk bad about somebody. You might be real good at talking real bad, but you don't know. They might be twice as good as you talking real bad, and they'll run you into the dirt. That's what the Bible's teaching, so don't do it. You might be outgunned. This I say then, walk in the Spirit, and ye shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. For the flesh lusts against the Spirit against the flesh. These are contrary the one to the other, so that you cannot do the things that you would. The Lord warns his disciples of a day when the love of many would wax cold. Notice that this chilling, this capacity to love others, becomes into iniquity. And because of iniquity, because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. This would not be our case if we lived and walked in the Spirit. But if ye be led of the Spirit, Paul says, ye are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh, here they are. Which are these? Adultery. You know what the difference between all fornication, and you understand, fornication is every sexual sin. Adultery is a married man or a married woman having a sexual liaison with something or someone else. And that's important to say someone or something else because they're breaking the marriage covenant. But a fornication is every type of sexual sin, be it homosexuality, bestiality, or adultery. That's what fornication is, you study your Bible. This premarital sex, you got that from the dictionary. But that's study your Bible. And that's the type of our fornication with God. We can fornicate on the Lord many ways with not only the idols that you make, but the idols of the heart that you find in Ezekiel. So what's the difference between adultery and fornication? God! That's it. You see, what God is joined together, God's in your marriage and God's joined together, then there's not going to be any adultery. You have to let something else and someone else come into that marriage to commit the adultery or the fornication. See? Your marriage should be consistent of three personalities. You, your spouse, and the Almighty. You get a fourth person and you've got fornication or adultery. The Lord warned his disciples of the day when love of many would wax cold. This wouldn't be our case. Okay, so here they are. Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulation, wrath, strife, sedition, heresy. Those things even sound good. They even sound bad. So what do you want to have? Look at envyings. You ever had envy? I have. See somebody else have something that you wish you could have and then you don't like him because that makes you feel miserable. Murders, drunkenness, revilings of such like which I tell you before, as I have told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy. Now look, see how good it is. Love, joy. I got that joy, joy, joy down in my peace. When peace like a river attendeth my soul, long suffering. Don't you like it when God tolerates you and puts up with you when he should have clobbered you? Gentleness. Isn't it nice when people are kindly affectionate and gentle to you? I mean, who likes to be pushed around and shoved around, you know? But we like to shove and push. Goodness. Goodness. Now, Jesus said something, and watch this. Now, watch this. This is going to be a small demonstration. Your pastor's going to profit from it. Not going to get rich over it, but he is going to get a small blessing. See, this dollar bill, this is mine, okay? That Bible says more blessed to give than receive. Now, here's the thing that you need to realize. Because I have a number of dollar bills in my pocket, I am well off. If he hadn't taken me out to eat dinner today and paid for that, I would have taken me out and paid for it, and I'm not in need. He just gave me a gift, see? So there's a buck for you. See, that's just a gift. It's more blessed to give than receive. You know why it's more blessed? Because poor people can't give. People without can't give. But when you have abundance, you can give. It's more blessed to give than receive. Now, see, how do you keep yourself in abundance? The labor is worthy of his hire. There you go. The labor is worthy of his hire. Mm-hmm. End of story. Life isn't complicated. People just make it that way.
Yeah.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lusts. If we live in the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. As a New Testament Christian living in the Spirit, we have no excuse to not walk in the Spirit filled with the love of men and the love of the brethren. Look at 1 John 3:14. We know that we have passed from death unto life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not his brother abideth in death. Now, this is very important. The world hates you because when you get saved, this is the strangest thing. When you get saved, when you really get saved, what'd you get saved from? You got saved from eternal damnation. You got saved from a fiery pit. You got saved from the dregs of hell. So what's the first thing when somebody really gets saved? The minute somebody gets saved, the first thing that happens naturally is, I got to tell somebody else. Somebody, the closest person to you, is like, I got saved. If I just got saved and I just got my eyes woke up, then they're in danger. And the first thing, the natural thing, is to tell somebody else. That's and right. The first thing they'll do is hate your guts for telling them the good news. And it's like, and it'll even be people, this is the thing. People, when I was lost, told me I needed a religion. You know, you gotta get some religion. You're too much of a sinner. Because I was a sinner exceedingly. And they tell me I needed something. And then when I found Christ, and I went back, well, remember you when? Hey? And we hate your guts because we don't like what you got in you now. Well, Jesus said that the world hates God. So what? They're selfish. They hate God. They're unthankful and unholy. That's the world. And so they hate the Lord. Now, the best testimony of your salvation is when you love the brethren, because now you're loving what Christ loved.
Yeah, that's right.
And if you don't love the brethren, that's a good testimony that you're not saved. Now, I didn't say you weren't. Once you're saved, a saved man can commit any sin. The only thing a saved man cannot do is he cannot go to hell. I understand my liberty. I understand the blood atonement. I understand the great salvation that I received. But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed one another. We know that we pass from death to life because we love the brethren. He that loveth not, this is what God says, he that loveth not his brother abideth in death. David and Jonathan were from different families with different destinies, yet they were brothers in Israel. They knew the love of men and of the brethren without the indwelling of the Spirit. In the Old Testament, the Old Spirit, the Holy Spirit would go into a man, but the Holy Spirit could leave a man.
Yeah.
In the Old Testament, the Holy Spirit come upon a man, but he could leave a man. But here's what David wrote. The beauty of Israel is slain upon the high places. How are the mighty fallen? Tell it not in Gath, publish it not in the streets of Ascalon. Lest the daughters of the Philistines rejoice, lest the daughters of the uncircumcised triumph. Ye mountains of Gibeah, let there be no dew, neither let there be rain upon you, nor fields of offering, for there the shield of the mighty is vilely cast away, the shield of Saul, as though he had not been anointed with oil. From the blood of the slain, from the fat of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan turned not back, and the sword of Saul returned not empty. Saul and Jonathan were lovely and pleasant in their lives, and in their death they were not divided. They were swifter than eagles, they were stronger than lions. Ye daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you in scarlet, with other delights, who put on ornaments of gold upon your apparel. How are the mighty fallen in the midst of battle? O Jonathan, thou wast slain in the high places. Do you realize that Saul spent a good part of his life trying to kill David? But David had respect to him for his office and his position, his calling, his anointing. I'm distressed for thee, Jonathan, my brother Jonathan. Very pleasant hast thou been unto me. Thy love to me was wonderful, passing the love of women. How are the mighty fallen, the weapons of war perish? Make no mistake, my friend, the glorious and holy love of the brethren is not today's vile, selfish lasciviousness, the repugnant homosexuality. Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. Neither were thankful, became vain in their imagination, their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools, and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image, made like corruptible men, and to birds, and four-footed beasts, and creeping things. Wherefore God has also given them up to uncleanness through the lust of their own hearts, to dishonor their own bodies between themselves, who change the truth of God into a lie and worship and serve the creature more than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. For this cause God gave them up to vile affections. Now they're saying that they were born that way, and they're saying that they want their liberty. God says their affections are vile. For even their women did change their natural use in that which is against nature. And likewise also the men, leaving the natural use of the women, burned in their lust one toward another, men with men, working that which is unseemly, and receiving in themselves their recompense of their error, which was meet. And even as they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. Men are not born atheists and reprobate. They must be educated by evil world philosophy to despise their walk before their Creator. The Bible says, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit after traditions of men, after the rudiments of the world, not after Christ. About every month, usually on one of the news stations, normally it's on the Fox News because they're the only ones that will report it, and you'll find somewhere in this country some highly educated educator decides a kindergarten class needs instruction in sexual conduct and condoms.
Yeah.
You're not born that way. You have to be educated to be that stupid. You have to be taught and trained through a worldly philosophy to be that pig-headed, that dumb, that ignorant, that backslidden, that depraved, that degenerate.
Yeah.
And you have to be educated to be a queer. You have to be taught vile affections. The Bible says, being filled with all unrighteousness, fornication, wickedness, covetousness, maliciousness, full of envy, murder, debate, deceit, malignity, whisperers, backbiters, haters of God, despiteful, proud, boasters, inventors of evil things, disobedient to parents, without understanding, covenant breakers, without natural affections, implacable, unmerciful, who knowing the judgment of God, they which commit such things are worthy of death. Now you got to be very careful there. You see, we're not under the law. Under the law, we take homosexuals and have them executed.
Yeah.
Now today, we just have to warn them that they're going to go to hell for their sins. They're worthy of death. You need to keep your distance from them. You need to say, except you repent, you all likewise perish. You need to remind them that God's fire came down on Sodom and Gomorrah because of their sexual improprieties. But it's not for us to harm them. We're New Testament Christians, holy, harmless, and undefiled. Not only do the same, but have pleasure in them to do them. They enjoy it. They get pleasure. They get gross, perverted pleasure. Now, I don't know about you, but you want to talk about sick. It's a sadomasochist, and a lot of that comes up. I don't know how anybody can get pleasure out of pain. You talk about an inverted, perverted person. I don't like pain, man. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I mean, hey, I was a wrestler. I was a football player. I've had some fist fights. I mean, and I did them because I was a man and got in those confrontations, and there was times that were right and times that were wrong, but I never liked the pain I got out of it. I sometimes like giving somebody else the pain. That's your carnal nature, see. But these sickos, they like pain. They're so sick, they can't get any satisfaction. I heard that in the message. I thought that was pretty good. Guy said, the only thing that Mick Jagger was ever right about in his life is he can't get no satisfaction. But Jesus satisfies.
Amen.
Amen. The love of men, the brethren, is comprehension, compassion on the innocent and the weak, where the lust and hatred of hell preys upon them. Did you catch that? The love of men and the brethren is compassion on the innocent and the weak, where the lust and hatred of hell preys upon them. You ever notice how bullies always pick on weak people instead of tough people?
Mm-hmm.
They're supposed to be tough, but the only way they can show they're tough is by punching out weak people. It hasn't happened to me too often, but I'll tell you one experience, and I still relish it. I don't know if I was completely right or not, but years ago, before I was saved, because I was raised in a rough culture. My brother and I went to watch a wrestling match, and we came out, and this punk came up to me, and he stuck his nose in my face, and I could smell his breath, and it stunk. And he said, "You looking at me?" Now, I wasn't stupid in those days. I was more mature for my age, and it didn't take my only a second to click, uh-oh, there ain't no way you're getting out of this. Because what he was going to do is he was going to try and make himself look like a big, tough kid by punching me out. And I didn't have any other choice. I did not answer him. I just hauled back and I punched him right square in the nose, trying to break that thing. And when he went down to the ground, I kicked him as hard as I could. I jumped on him and I punched him till he stopped moving. And I grabbed my brother and went and got in the car and went home. You say, should you have done that? I don't know. I was lost, but I'll tell you what. It was better for him to have the pain than me. He was the one who started the trouble. Should have never started it. You say, should a Christian do that? I don't know. But I don't know if a Christian ought to just stay around and let some wicked person always abuse them. Now, I've taken hits for the Lord. I've been out street preaching where I've had people try to pull me down. I've had people try to start fights with me. I walk away. Now, see, that wasn't one of those things where you could walk away. The crowd was there, and he was before me, and he wasn't going to let me. If I went this way, he'd have done the same. And sometimes you get in a situation like that, it's strike and go and get out of there. Now, I'm not teaching that for the average Christian. Now, if you can turn the other cheek, I will. If you can turn around and walk the other way, I will. No. If you can walk to the left or walk to the right, I will. If you go that way, I'll go this way. You go that way, then I'll go this way. I don't want to have that type of confrontation. But when you get those sickos, and they're out to just harm you, and it doesn't matter what you do, then my recommendation is drop them and go home. I'm sorry to say that. Then said he unto disciples, it is impossible that offenses will come. But woe unto him through whom they come. It were better for him that a millstone were hanged about his neck and he cast in the sea, that he should offend one of these little ones. Where the love of marriage is honorable and the bed undefiled, it requires reciprocity. It is often soft, can be effeminate, it can be sensual. The love of marriage is best described as the love of women. It's not the love of men. It's not love of the brethren. However, it is also holy. It is upright, and the upright seek it. Mm-hmm. Song of Solomon, which is Solomon's. Let him kiss me with the kisses of his mouth, for thy love is better than wine. Because of the savor of thy good ointments, thy name is ointment poured forth. Therefore do the virgins love thee. Draw me, and we will run after thee. The king hath brought me into his chambers, and we'll be glad and we'll rejoice in thee. We'll remember thy love more than wine. The upright love thee. Now, I've just demonstrated that this morning. But this is my wife, and what she needs of me is a gentle man. She needs a kind man. She needs a caring man. She needs a man that'll love her. Okay? That's the love of women. And if my wife needs me to be soft and gentle and even a little feminine, I will be. Now, when I walk amongst men, if there's a feminine side of me, I'll kill it. Because the love of men, that's different. Love of men needs to be strong, it needs to be loyal, it needs to endure, it needs to be able to stand, having done all to stand there for. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, let the Lord even require it at the hand of David's enemies. And Jonathan caused David to swear again, because he loved him, for he loved him as his own soul. The love of men arises from the depths and the searches of the heart. And it's total, it's sacrificial, it's holy, it's just, and it's righteous. And it came to pass when he made an end of speaking unto Saul, that the soul of Jonathan was knit with the soul of David. And Jonathan loved him as his own soul. And Saul took him that day and would let him no more home to his father's house. Then Jonathan and David made a covenant because he loved him as his own soul. And Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was upon him. That's his deity. And gave it to David and his garments. That's his clothing. That's his righteousness. White linen is the righteousness of the saints. Even to a sword. That's his weapon of war, and that's his defense, and to his bow, and that's his artillery, and to his girdle that upholds his manhood and his righteousness and his dignity. And David went out whatsoever Saul sent him and behaved himself wisely. And Saul sent over the men of war, and he was accepted in the sight of all the people, and also in the sight of Saul's servant. The love of men will take a man through the terrors and trials of Calvary's cross. When John was there and Jesus was on the cross, he said, woman, behold thy son! Then saith he to the disciple, behold thy mother. From that hour the disciple took her unto her own home. The love of men and the brethren is a mark of a mature Christian. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in the world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. If any man say, I love God and hate his brother, he is a liar. For he that loveth not his brother, whom he has seen, how can he love God who he hath not seen? And this commandment we have from him, that he who loveth God love his brother also. The love of God and godly men is the salvation of families. It causes men to be the husbands and fathers that they should be, but often fail to be. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoner heard them. And suddenly there was a great earthquake, so that the foundation of the prison was shaken. And immediately all the doors were opened, and everyone's bands was loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison door open, he drew out a sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, "Do thyself no harm, for we're all here." Then he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house." Now, what I want you to see, that's household salvation. That's not a guaranteed thing. See, what it is, when the man of the house will play the man and walk like a man and talk like a man and be a godly man, the chances are 99 of 100 his entire house will get saved because of his manhood in Christ. That's almost a guaranteed thing. If you'll walk like a man and talk like a man and play the man, your children will respect you, your wife will reverence you, and your family will get saved. You want to be a scoundrel, you'll send them to hell. The love of men belongs only to the soldiers of the cross. And it's the mark of true discipleship. I'll show you this last thing and then we'll close. And David longed. He said, "Oh, that one would give me drink of the water of the well of Bethlehem, which is by the gate. And the three mighty men break through the host of the Philistines and drew water out of the well of Bethlehem that was by the gate and took it and brought it to David. Nevertheless, he would not drink thereof, but poured it unto the Lord. And he said, Be it far from me, O Lord, that I should do this. Is not this the blood of the men that went in jeopardy of their lives? Therefore he would not drink it. These things did these three mighty men." David was a man of immense character. We know of his character flaws, but David and Jonathan were highly character men. They were soldiers. They were God's soldiers. They were soldiers of the cross in the Old Testament. And David was a man that his men loved and respected. And he's in this battle, and it's hot, and it's thirsty, and he's got that summer thirst where you've been sweating and sweating, and you can't get to a drink of water, and your throat is parched. And he says, "Oh, that I only had a drink from that cold, cool well of water at Bethlehem." And his men overheard it, and they loved him as their own soul. And they ventured their lives. They took their swords, and they broke through. You're talking man-to-man combat. Swords and blood and guts and head and guts and And they killed these men and broke through to get a glass of water, and they brought it back to David, whom they loved, because they knew that he loved them. And he took that cup of water, and he saw that they had ventured their lives and risked their life, and he realized that that was their blood in that cup. That wasn't just water. And he poured that thing out to the Lord and said, "I won't drink it." You know why he wouldn't drink that? Because he didn't want them to do it again. If he drank that water, they'd gone again until they got themselves killed. He had to pour that water out to stop them from risking their lives for him.
Yeah.
See that? Is this love of the soul? This is the love of men. This is the love of the brethren that brought the Lord of glory to this earth to offer himself as a sacrifice. You see, that's the love of Christ. Christ saw our need, and he came and offered himself willingly. This is the propitiation for our souls. And as Moses lifted up a serpent in the wilderness, even so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have ever eternal life. You see, what we're failing to do today is really lift the Savior up as he is in his holiness, in his manliness, in his righteousness, in his truth, in his justice, in his compassion, and really lift him up to give him the preeminence in all things. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him should not perish but have everlasting life. To him whom the Father hath given the Spirit without measure belongs the love of men and the love of the brethren. Jesus said, "I am the good shepherd, and the good shepherd giveth his life for the sheep." You know what the mark of a soldier is? Real soldiers, I'm sorry, they'll give you this romance stuff. Real soldiers don't die for their country. They don't die for their flag. Real soldiers die for each other. You want to train men to be a lean, green fighting machine? You train them, no man left behind. You give them Semper Fi. You give them, we go in together, we come out together, and we don't leave anybody behind. And when you train men like that, when men get that kind of training, and men get that kind of commitment, when they get filled with that love of men, they're going to win every time. They're going to be a superior fighting force. That's why the Israeli Air Force took down its enemies 80 to nothing. That's why this little teeny country thumps all of its enemies. Because until recent history, every Jewish soldier went to Masada. And every Jewish soldier would swear on the Old Testament Bible, "Never again!" Because Masada, over 900 Jews sacrificed themselves when they were completely surrounded. And their motto is never again. Never again will they have a Masada. The whole country's going down together. Back during the 67 war, when things looked really rough, Moshe Dayan went to Gotamir. They were going to drop the bomb on the Arabs. Because they're not going to let the state go down. They're taking everybody down with them. Because they're one man. They're one spirit. Now, they're not God's men right now. Israel's in blindness. But we're not. And we should be filled with the love of men. We ought to be in love with each other. We want to be willing to fight for each other. We want to be willing to die for each other. And we should not want to ever take advantage of one another. Now, let me ask you this question. If you were to die tonight, would you go to heaven or hell? If you're honest with yourself, the Bible says, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, for there's none righteous." If you want to be honest with yourself, you don't have the love of men. I don't have the love of men. The only time I'll have the love of men is when the Spirit of Christ fills me and fills my soul and I submit to Him. But you can't do that unless you're saved, born again. You must first be born again, born of Spirit. Why don't you come today and pray this prayer? Bow your head. "Dear Lord Jesus, be mercifully a sinner. I'll trust you as my Lord and Savior. Forgive me of my weakness and my sin and my vile and wickedness. Thank you for your mercy and your goodness. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen."